This is part two of a two-part video series, so if you haven't seen the first part of the video, I suggest you click the first link in the description, and then it'll take you back to part one. And if you haven't seen part one, I really suggest you watch it, or else you'll be really confused, because we're just going to start talking about Beyond Two Souls. Either way, enjoy the video.
Just to set the mood for this game, here's a friendly reminder that David Cage thought the best idea to prove to Ellen Page that she should be in this game is to compile pictures of her when she was a little child to present day, and then show her that he compiled it. Somehow, Ellen Page decided, yeah, you know what? This guy's not creepy at all. I'm gonna join it. That came back to bite her in the ass because after Ellen Page explicitly said that she does not want to do a full nude scene for the game, someone at Quantic Dream still decided to give her a full nude model for her shower scene. You don't even see her nude body, but they still modeled it. Well, once that model leaked onto the internet, let's just say I don't think Ellen Page is going to be working again with David Cage anymore. But enough talk about all that bullshit. Let's do what David Cage wants us to do and judge him by his work.
One more thing before we really get started. The remastered version provides two ways to play through the game, one in chronological order, and one in the original order. We'll be playing through the game the original way, firstly to show you how much of a mess it is, and secondly, because David thought this was a good idea. This is still the recommended and intended way to go about the story. Keep that in mind.
So the game starts with an uncomfortable close-up of Ellen Page's face, where she talks about images and ghosts and shit. You also get flashes of moments that have happened much earlier in the game's timeline, so that's always a good sign. We then cut to Ellen being held by Louis C.K. cop and see that she is a wanted criminal. We also have Willem Dafoe screaming about her knowing where Spider-Man is or something, and guess what? I already have no idea what's even going on in this fucking game and have no investment in these characters whatsoever. Fucking great start, David.
Jump cut again. Green Goblin arrives at the police station and Jody literally has murdered all the cops. Except for Louis C.K., of course, because you have to show the scared person who's now traumatized by the random powers. After that, we cut to the timeline. You see that? All the way at the end of the fucking timeline, right there? Yeah, that's the fucking prologue. All the way at the end. It's gonna be a long fucking game.
So then we cut to little baby Ellen Page, where she is being monitored 24/7 in a controlled environment. This is basically how David Cage found all those pictures of Ellen Page, but I digress. We then get to walk around as Baby Page, and one thing I can say about this game is graphically, it still holds up insanely well today. Now obviously the lens flare and all that bullshit is still stupid, and is only there because Cage would rather make a movie, but it still is impressive for the time. Anyways, you can fuck around a little in the environment before being told by one of the scientists that they need you for an experiment.
So we head down the hall, being led by a scientist named Cole, who's basically our dad, and he takes her to a weird room where we discover our sweet supernatural powers. Essentially, in-game, we can take control of this character named Iden and have him affect things in the world separate from the main character, Jody. But we'll just call her Ellen Page anyways. So, the whole idea behind Iden is that you get to fuck around and control him, and you can either choose to be cooperative or a total dick. But in a lot of scenes, you don't even get a choice. The game makes you do what it needs to do to progress the story. Seriously, while Heavy Rain has a ton of choices, there are basically no choices in this game that actually matter. Like, even in this single scene, you can either tell Iden to keep fucking around or tell him to stop, but Jody ends up delivering the same line anyways, so it seems like really not much changes.
Okay, Jody, honey, the experiment is over.
It will never be over.
So after all this traumatic stuff happening in her childhood, what's the next best point to go to? Well, when she's a full-on adult, of course! Yeah, we are now cutting to her as an adult who was in the fucking CIA? What? Wait, what? What? Like, you just can't introduce all this random bullshit and expect us to be okay with it, David. One moment we are a child learning the extent of our ghost powers, next thing you know, we're doing secret undercover missions for the CIA? We're like 20 minutes into the game, and it has already done like 3 time skips and lost focus on what it even wants to be.
In this section, we need to discover some super secret documents from the evil terrorist dudes or something. I don't know, they haven't even told us yet. All you're told to do is to find a quiet place. Then, after that, you fly around with Iden for like 15 minutes because you have no clue what you're actually looking for. They literally don't explain it! Eventually, you get into the safe you need to and you transcribe the information. Also, Iden is really far away from Ellen at this point, and that sort of thing is really painful for her. Keep this in mind moving forwards. Iden can't go too far from Ellen without fucking her up and causing her nose to bleed.
So then Ellen Page and the random partner love interest dude reunite and leave this party they have only been at for like 10 minutes. This totally isn't suspicious at all, especially when the guy's date was in the bathroom for like 8 of those 10 minutes, but whatever. So now for another time skip to the fucking best scene in the game! Here we have Ellen Page as a young teenager being invited to a party with a couple of other hip, cool, teenage kids. Yeah, this is David Cage trying to imagine what human children actually act like. Remember, David Cage is not human. He is a French reptile that hides in the skin of a fat, aging, bald man.
Ellen heads into the house and it becomes abundantly clear she doesn't know any of these fucking people. Also, these guys have the stupidest blinds of all time. Why are they shutters? What is this even for? So there's a bunch of awkward, cringy dialogue from people pretending to be teenagers.
Woo! Party time! I'll get the beer. Guys, do the shutters. Girls, do the candles. And Jody, you can take care of the music. Let's get crazy!
And then you make out with some British dude. Then they ask you to demonstrate your super mega ghost powers, and you scare the shit out of them. But it's okay, because it's time to open presents!
What is that?
An old book. It smells funky. It's a really rare collection, poems by Edgar Allan Poe.
Edgar Allan who?
Hold up! These fucks don't know who Edgar Allan Poe is! They aren't first graders, David! They should know who he is! But anyways, the main chick at the party gets mad, and then everyone just turns on Ellen Page. Like, I'm not saying they just start calling her names. No. But they try fucking burning her while calling her a slut and a witch.
What do you do with witches? You burn them.
Get her!
Even the sexy British guy who kissed you and grabbed your ass. Like, this scene just takes a complete 180 and it just comes out of nowhere. There's no build up to this. Like we said earlier, in a David Cage game, you were either the nicest person ever who could do no wrong, or the most evil person with no redeemable qualities. By the way, we're only like an hour into this.
They lock you into the closet, like any normal teenager would do, and you shortly escape with the help of Aiden. Afterwards, you can either choose to leave or take the correct option and get your revenge. You freak everyone the fuck out, beat the shit out of them, stab the sexy British guy, and then burn their house down. That's right, you literally burn the house down. The best part of all is that this literally changes nothing, and it never gets mentioned again in the entire story. Honestly, even if it did get mentioned again, you probably wouldn't even notice because we're probably going to jump forward like 80 years when Ellen's already dead.
We actually do the opposite of that. We have another fucking time skip that has us back to being a young girl who's telling the Green Goblin about her ghost powers. This scene really adds nothing other than it showing how the Green Goblin learned about her powers. So let's just move on. Another time skip has us in fucking boot camp? What? Yeah, the Green Goblin decides to send our ass off to the military! And we now have a large training montage with Ellen Page. This whole part is basically a tutorial to teach us how to control Aiden and Page. But this just goes to show that this game has no idea what it wants to be. It's just David Cage. Also, it doesn't tell us anything that we already don't know. Like we've been playing this game for like an hour now. We should know how to do most of the stuff they tell us what to do. Whatever.
You spend 20 minutes going through the tutorial montage to show how Ellen Page starts to learn this shit. It's boring as hell. Let's just jump through time again, and now you're running away from the cops. It's pretty confusing, honestly. The time jumping is not helping the story, and jumping between being chased by the cops and working for them is pretty jarring. Regardless, we fuck around on a train for about an hour, and then the cops stop the train to investigate. This totally makes sense, but once they get on the train, it starts again? And it's like, what the hell? Who thinks this is a good idea? I guess it's meant to stop the criminal from getting off or something, but doesn't that just endanger lives? What if they find a bomb on it or something? I don't know, it seems pretty dumb to me.
Anyways, the cops find Ellen Page and they start chasing her on the train. She then decides to climb up onto the roof of the train where the cops follow her. Now, this is stupid for multiple reasons. Why don't the cops just tell the conductor to stop the train? Why do they think that the best course of action is to just climb up there and start fighting this trained CIA chick who has a ghost? Also, this fight scene makes no sense and it's just super dumb. How everyone on the roof is not falling off is a mystery. Either way, Ellen Page gets cornered and has to jump off the train. Luckily, Aiden has a force field move that protects her, and you're starting to learn by now that Aiden is OP as shit. He is literally the most broken thing of all time, and is literally only there to save Ellen Page at the last second or be a MacGuffin. There are much more dangerous situations later on in the game where this force field would have come in handy, but Aiden just doesn't use it. He doesn't want to. It's lazy writing. That's all it is. It's lazy writing.
And now you have to run from the cops, who are somehow already right on your tail. You beat the shit out of some dogs and climb up a cliff. By the way, if you fail any of these things, nothing really happens. You just retry the climb and the cops never catch up to you. There's zero risk to it. Aiden possesses some dudes and causes a distraction, which lets us steal a motorbike. Aiden once again uses his bullshit magic shield to stop all the bullets from hitting us, and then after a bit more driving, you end up cornered by the cops.
Here is a perfect example of Aiden being stupidly overpowered. You basically find these insane and stupidly complex ways to kill all the SWAT guys there. Also, some inconsistencies in the scene is how stupidly far Aiden can go during the scene while having it not even hurt Jody. Also, what constitutes who he can and cannot possess or choke to death? Some people he can do it to, others he cannot. Is it their inner strength or some bullshit? It is all just horribly explained and confusing. But Jody kills all but one guy and says this heroic line.
Tell them to leave me the fuck alone, because next time, I'll kill everyone.
This is our hero! This is our protagonist!
And how do you follow up this horrible mass murder? Ellen Page is a little kid getting fucking haunted. Yeah, it's really dumb. Like, man, I really relate to this poor little kid, especially now that I know her fucking body count. After that short cutscene, we play as Kid Jody walking around the house and doing nothing special. But eventually we get to head outside and it's time for a fucking snowball fight.
Hey Jody, wanna play with us? Come on, hurry up and hide then, you're gonna get cream!
Now, like we said, everyone in the David Cage game has to be an asshole to the main character, so the kids take it too far and start shoveling snow in her face. Look at this fucking kid. He's loving it! He's having the biggest orgasm of his life! This fucking kid is 100% going to grow up and be a sexual deviant. But of course, Aiden has to ruin his fun and start choking the fucking kid out. And once again, this is David Cage showing his irresistible love of the murdering of children.
You've lost,
David.
What will you gain with one more victim? Huh? Look at these,
David.
Look at these! 8 photographs, 8 lives taken, drowned in the goddamn rain!
Even then, Ellen Page forces Aiden to back off like the little bitch she is. This causes all the children to freak out and call her a witch, even though normal kids would just chalk that up to him having a fucking allergic reaction or something. Not that she's a fucking witch.
Now the dad walks up not wearing a jacket or anything, even though it's freezing out. David Cage really doesn't understand the cold at all, does he?
You guys are babies. It's not that cold. I haven't worn a coat since I was 5 years old.
And now, we get to see just how much of an asshole the dad is as well. Seriously, either you're the best person in a David Cage game, or you're an absolute unredeemable ass. Can you guess which one the father is?
Jody, this time you're really gonna get it!
Then we get to see some stupid marital issues, and Ellen gets attacked by the ghost from Paranormal Activity. It's boring, it's dumb, let's move on.
Time skip number 5000 has us moving on to a sleeping Ellen Page getting woken up by the Green Goblin, who basically tells her she's the only one who can solve this horrible problem. What's the problem, you may ask? Basically, scientists pulled a Doom and opened a portal to hell, and the only option they have is to send in the 16-year-old girl. Yeah, fuck the Doom Slayer. Little girl with ghost stand will do just fine. A job that literally trained SWAT team members couldn't fix is going to be fixed by a little girl who can't control her ghost. And remember, this is before she gets the CIA training. Also, we learn a little later on that all the entities that came out of the portal are like Aiden and can go through walls. So why the fuck haven't they just escaped from the building? Why isn't this a worldwide epidemic? Are they too scared to leave the building? Will David Cage ever learn how to write a fucking story?
On the note of David Cage being unable to write, for some reason we can use Iden to channel some fart gas right up Ellen Page's nose, and it gives us flashbacks from the dead people's memories. It makes no sense. Why does this work all of a sudden? Why didn't she do this when we were flashed forward before? Anyways, the spirits possess some scientists, giving them serious neck problems, and they try to rape Ellen again. But of course, we get away with little issue. We encounter the Hellgate that's surrounded by the robots from the Matrix, and we walk over and close it.
One thing here that makes no sense is that Ellen Page thinks that Iden got sucked into the portal. She can't see Iden for a couple seconds, but then all of a sudden he appears again. What happened here? Why was Iden just fucking with Ellen here and not doing anything? Was he just pissed off at her and wanted to fuck with her? It's a small thing, but it's irritating. But anyways, now we get to the next section. The section literally called Homeless. David Cage just loves making you homeless in his games, so gotta add a whole chapter dedicated to her being homeless. She calls Green Goblin and literally says nothing and passes out on the street. Luckily, this dirty homeless man doesn't rape Ellen Page. I know, fucking shocking. And takes her back to his hobo lounge. Yes, this is basically the hobo lounge from Indigo Prophecy. Instead of it being an underground organization, it is just a gang of hobos in this game. You have the druggie, the pregnant one, the nice guy, and the funny black man. The gang's all here!
Now that we're hanging with the homeless crew, there's only one thing left to do. Kill ourselves. And no, I'm not joking. Ellen walks to a drop in the freeway and jumps right in. And honestly, Ellen Page does a great job of acting this stuff throughout the entire game. She delivers a pretty compelling performance, but it's hard to actually get super invested because it seems like nothing really matters. And that's right, it doesn't matter here either. Choose to jump, well, Iden saves you, and you might as well have not jumped in the first place. And look, unless you play through the game multiple times, it might not be clear that the choices you make always pan out the same. But it's incredibly serious decisions like choosing to kill yourself that end up very obviously changing nothing and show how little branching there is in the game. A choice as important as this should have serious consequences, or may as well not be in the game at all. Also, Indigo Prophecy is better, because at least you can actually kill yourself. By the way, Shelby has asthma.
So after Ellen Page tries to commit suicide, she goes out on the street to beg for money. This section is just one long stretch of being homeless. It's so fucking boring that even writing about it makes me go hollow inside. Now I would just skip over this. But this scene has probably one of the grossest and most pointless scenes of all time. While begging for money, this weird guy comes up to Ellen and basically says, Hey, come on, suck my cock, I'll give you some money. So if you accept, you follow him into the back alley and prepare to suck his little pecker. Once you get back there, you get a final choice to either do it or don't. Thing is though, once again, it doesn't matter. Ellen Page just backs off either way and then the guy says, fuck you, and tries to rape her. Here's my issue, other than the relatively pointless rape, is the fact that Ellen is struggling and needs Iden to kill the guy for her. Here's the issue. This is after all her CIA training and her beating up and killing multiple cops. Are you telling me she can't take on one fucking middle-aged fat dude who's literally caught with his pants down? You can't even say that she is too weak because she is homeless, because literally a scene later, spoilers, she beats up four guys at one time who have weapons. The fact that David Cage puts her in this situation and limits her abilities while then a scene later having her back to her original strength all for a pointless rape scene is disgusting. Also, 5 seconds later, she just leaves and acts like it never happens. I am not kidding when I say I despise this game.
Once we've got the money, we head back to the nice guy who saved us and give him the cash. He heads to the grocery store and buys some food. But oh no, the most evil characters David Cage's puny mind could imagine show up once again. This time it's three guys robbing the nice homeless man while his friend films. Okay, look, I've never been homeless, but are there really this many people trying to shit on the homeless? It seems a little insane to me. You almost get raped and robbed in the same day. And like Vinny said, she easily takes down these three dudes armed with weapons, and Iden doesn't even help. How come she couldn't defend herself from the David Cage stand-in, but we can easily defeat three armed men? Whatever. Ellen saves the day once again with her sick kung fu moves, and we head back to camp with the spoils.
So after her long day, she eats food while learning about the colorful cast of characters here. Like I said earlier, they are pretty one-dimensional and boring. So after this long day, Ellen Page finally gets a good night's sleep. Oh, but wait! Pregnant lady is going into labor! Apparently she is having the most eventful day of her life because on top of all the other shit that happened, she has to now deliver a fucking baby. But first, we need to fetch some things from the convenience store, while the other colorful characters take Prego Bego to an abandoned apartment building, because that's... safer? Also, she takes along Mr. Nice Guy to help her. Once they get to the shop to get some supplies, oh no, it's locked! Whatever shall they do? Iden solves the issue in 1 second. Great. Well, okay, that was pretty conveniently easy and pointless. It really only exists to show Mr. Nice Guy that she has powers, which he doesn't really react to. He's just like, oh, wow, how'd you do that?
Damn, how the hell did you do that?
No time to explain. Let's just take what we need and get out of here.
And then we deliver a fucking baby. Yeah, that's right. You even cut the umbilical cord. This is why I play video games right here, everyone. The screen cuts to black and then you wake up with a whole fucking building on fire. For absolutely no reason. Man, what an eventful day! Homeless people really have exciting lives! We do a bunch of cheaty fire-resistant shit with Iden to save everyone and make our way out of the house. Okay, I know I was just complaining about helping with childbirth being too boring for a video game, but this is just stupid. Either way, we end up passing out so that David can deliver some sick exposition right down our fucking throats. Oh yeah, give it to me, David. Give it to me like how you gave Ellen Page a nude model.
We see a clip of Ellen being separated from her biological mother, and don't forget this, it'll become super important way later into the story. Oh, by the way, David Cage watched Terminator before making this game, just in case you didn't know. I mean, look at this shit. It's fucking Sarah Connor. Also, we found out pregnant lady's baby survived, but like, I don't really care. But after all that dumb bullshit, Ellen Page wakes up from a coma that she's been in for like 9 months, and only now, as soon as she wakes up, does the Secret Service come to take her away. Talk about good timing, considering the fact that the Secret Service couldn't find her while she was unconscious for this fucking long. Either way, Ellen Page jumps out the window to get away. Or maybe trying to kill herself again, I don't know.
Then, after that, Ellen Page wanders through the streets. We actually see the cop from the prologue pull up and let us into his car. Finally, maybe we'll get some actual linear connections in what's going on right now. Nah, fuck that though, she's like 7 years old again. We get back to the point where our parents are dropping us off at Green Goblin's lair, and the two scientists tuck us into bed. Remember how she gets randomly attacked by ghost spirits at night? Yeah, me neither, but here it is again. I really don't know what it is with David Cage and these tiny plot points that keep recurring. It's basically the Shelby has asthma thing, but even dumber because they're stupid ghost spirits now. Regardless, Green Goblin comes to the rescue and we jump in time again to the best Ellen Page.
Look at this fucking edgelord over here. David really pulled no punches with this. The dumbass short hair with purple highlights, the sick ass guitar, the fuck the established attitude. He's really going all in here. Ellen Page wants to go out with her friends to some bar, but Green Goblinator says she's too young. So our hero does what all noble heroes would do. Fucking possesses Cole and sneaks out while controlling him. And what does she do once she's done controlling Cole? Leave him out in the fucking woods by himself, confused and scared. That's what all great heroes would do.
Now we head into the shadiest looking building you could possibly imagine to apparently meet our friends? They don't show up. We chill by ourselves until the creepiest dude in the world asks us to play pool. And then he tries to rape us. Surprisingly. Luckily, Iden steps in again and saves us. If you thought us burning down some kid's house was bad, don't worry. This time we commit a triple homicide. And okay, this was in self-defense, but this is some fucked up shit. But that's not even the best part. Apparently, David Cage intended for you to be able to not fight them off as Iden, which would result in Ellen actually getting raped. This whole thing got cut from the game, but the audio files still exist. And in them, you can hear Ellen Page crying out to Iden and asking why he chose not to help. It's pretty fucked up, and it just shows how much of a total sleazebag David Cage is.
So of course, the most appropriate part to go to after a rape scene is to Ellen Page as a little girl. Here we are learning about how her parents abandoned her with two scientists in the lab. They both give half-assed goodbyes, and Ellen Page in a fit of rage has Iden choke and almost kill her father. I hate this game if you can't tell, but gonna be honest here, I have no problems with this scene, other than the fact that it was right after a rape scene. Her dad is an asshole and he really deserved it, and it makes sense from her perspective. Even right after, you start to feel for her even more once you see the dad freak out on little baby Ellen Page. This is what makes David Cage so frustrating for me, as there are hints of something actually good in this game, but they are never really fully realized or overshadowed by stupid shit. It's really just a shame.
And now that we had that really emotionally impactful scene, let's jump to one of the most offensive and unimportant segments of the game, which is somehow able to be the longest fucking section. Ellen Page is walking through the desert, but suddenly she stumbles upon a quaint little house. We knock on the door and the dude there is a total dick. Luckily, his dad shows up and invites us for dinner. We have dinner with them and head to bed, but wake up in the middle of the night because of a big spooky dream. We head out of the room and find out why they'd been boarding up all the windows and didn't want you to leave your room. Fucking ghosts.
Can't forget, though, that Jody has a weird fucking dream where she sees stupidly fucking offensive portrayals of Native Americans and also a close-up of that sexy grandma action. Either way, she wakes up the next day and decides to stay and helps out this totally not suspicious family. Because, you know, the shadiest fucking family in existence and giant hauntings that shake the entire fucking house isn't enough of a red flag for her. So you spend like 20 minutes doing pointless shit, which isn't helped by the fact that you move so fucking slow, and then afterwards decide to take a shower. And time for another rape scene! Oh, wait, nah, it's just the dude creepily watching her shower and writing cryptic bullshit on the wall. But I bet everyone going through this the first time thought that was gonna be another rape scene. Sadly, we aren't lucky enough.
More filler happens, and then Ellen decides to sneak out of the house. And the stupidest shit in the world happens. I don't even know what to say about this. It's literally the thing from The Mummy. Some ghost men save you, and then you find out the truth. It's not just a ghost. It's a Native American ghost! Ellen goes back to bed and fucks around on horses for a while longer. We walk around and gather a bunch of fucking clues that basically show us the past and how they've sealed off the mummy, but now he's back. For a vengeance.
This stupid dumb ghost shit going on is making me have flashbacks to Indigo, and let me tell you, that's not a good thing! So Ellen Page goes all the way back to the house where she finds that Paul got fucked super hard by the ghost, which is strange considering that they used to only come out at night, but whatever. So Ellen Page gets Paul back into the house safely, and old-ass Granny finally talks. She says how she must reverse the curse by completing the ritual, and that she has the final piece. So Ellen Page gets them all to stand in a circle, Granny says some racist mumbo-jumbo, and opens up a sky vagine. Now all that shit, that's not enough. We also need the ghosts of dead spirits to scare away the evil ghosts with their ghost torches. Getting real mad Indigo prophecy flashbacks!
Everything works out, and we seal off the mummy once again, but not without the old grandma dying. But who actually cares? We bury her, kiss the attractive guy, and head off on a motorcycle they gave us that looks as old as the ghost we just sealed off. Now we jump back in time to discover how Ellen got the fart-smelling power in the first place. Green Goblin is training her on how to see the past, when suddenly he has to go talk to someone.
Here we find out that, oh no, Ellen Page got drafted into the army, because goddammit, if we can't use the ghost girl for science, we sure as hell can use her to fuck shit up with ISIS. So skipping past all this emotional shit that we don't care about because we already knew this was gonna happen, we get to her a couple years later in an apartment. Apparently she's been treated pretty well, and we see that she has the hots for the one guy we've seen a couple of times. I'm not kidding, we know next to nothing about him, other than the fact that he was the one who drafted her to the military, and he helped train her. But because he's super hot, we gotta date his ass. So Ellen Page is a super long and boring section where she's getting ready for the date. It actually is kind of fun fucking with her before the date is Iden, but it does get stale pretty fast. Also, gotta be walking around her underwear, gotta have another shower sequence!
We have dinner with this character we've barely met, and man, can I just say how pointless so much of this game has been so far? The whole section in the desert was completely fucking pointless. Why are we doing this? It's not like this character development is very helpful since we don't even know the fucking characters. Regardless, this shit happens and we either fuck up the date and Ryan leaves, or it goes well and you sleep with the guy. Time jump back again to young Ellen Page, where we don't really learn much about her. But the Green Goblin gets a call where he finds out his whole family died in a car accident. If you didn't already guess, this is actually where the original Spider-Man begins.
But nah, forget about that boring shit, because now we at war! So after teasing it for this entire fucking game, we finally get to see Ellen Page in action at her fucking job. So she basically has to take out this African warlord guy as she's told by super hot boyfriend Ryan. Which, just a heads up, Jody fucking moves around in this game. I mean, we just had a scene with her kissing some Native American dude, and now we have her kissing some other dude. Either way, it's time to play shitty Metal Gear ripoff, except here, you can't lose. So fuck it, find all sorts of stupid ways to abuse the AI and get caught, because remember, none of your actions have any consequences whatsoever. Game overs are a failure of the game designer.
You go around murdering a bunch of dudes, and eventually you find this injured little kid and heal his wounds with Iden. Yes, seriously. Iden is the most powerful entity in the fucking universe. If only he wasn't attached to this whiny little girl. Regardless, you run around with this kid, killing more dudes and just having an all-around great time. Eventually, after enough Metal Gear Solid 4, we find the evil warlord we're supposed to kill, and murder like 30 people. After this happens, Ellen comes in to bag and tag the body, and the little boy we saved earlier runs in as well. Apparently one of the guys we killed was the kid's father. Man, we really goofed up this time. We run out and get shot in the leg, because apparently Aiden can't protect us this time. Then, surrounded by hundreds of dudes, they just don't, like, try very hard to kill us for some reason. We heal our bullet wound and head up to the helicopter and head home. Oh, and let's just ignore how stupid it is that Aiden can heal bullet wounds and literally stop bullets, but only when he really feels like it. Later, when we're flying back, we find out that the dude we were asked to kill wasn't actually a warlord, but actually the president. Why didn't Ellen do any research? She could have easily found this out. Really, really fucking easily. Either way, she gets pissed off, jumps out of the helicopter, and after landing from the jump, she calls Cole to meet up again, which they do in the next scene.
No, Shane, you're wrong. It's actually after Navajo, not right after she jumps out.
Jesus Christ, dude. We're watching this back after playing it, and I still can't keep track of this shit. I mean, seriously, look at the fucking timeline at this point.
Moving on, we see Ellen Page meeting up with Cole while still being a wanted fugitive. You know, meeting up in a fucking park in the bright of day when the fucking Secret Service is after you might not be the best idea, but I don't know, what do I know? She has a heartfelt reunion with him, even though there was that one time she left him to go get eaten by bears, but hey, water under the bridge! She then asks him to take her to his mom, and he's just like, eh, fuck it, why not? So then we have another mission where we have to sneak Jody into, you guessed it, an insane asylum. Don't worry. It's not handled as bad as Indigo Prophecy. Once you sneak all the way there, you find your mom basically brain dead and have to basically go inside her mind to talk to her and... Oh shit. Oh my god. This is the exact same plot as Stranger Things. Holy shit. Even up to when she was taken away at birth... I think I need to lie down. Oh, fuck. Oh, I don't feel so good. Shit, I like Stranger Things. I can't wait until Stranger Things has 4 episodes related to her fighting evil Native American ghosts while protecting the Indigo Child from the Origami Killer.
Also, at this point, you can choose to stop your mom's heart, which is honestly kind of fucked up. Again, it doesn't change anything. We get caught and end up in what looks like an evil villain's lair. But it's no villain, everyone. It's the Green Goblin. We find out that he's been building a super portal to the other world, which, when you think about it, sounds like something else I've heard of. Anyways, we find out that the Chinese found out about the Upside Down too, and we don't want any of those damn commies to abuse the kind of power it could give you. We agree to infiltrate this base for some reason and get our motley crew of boys to join us.
But of course, let's have an insanely jarring jump cut here to show you that you guys are fucking dumbasses and got caught. And then you start the mission. Why would you fucking do that, Cage? This whole game has shown us time and time again that David doesn't understand how a story works. Since we already know that they're going to get caught, all the tension in the scene is gone. We already know that everything is going to get fucked, so why should we even care about what happens? Whatever, they dress up as the characters from Minutemen and go off on their merry way to find the Chinese base.
Ellen spots some Chinese military while she's taking a piss and alerts everyone of it. You find out that they've got some dumb small base full of submarines. Ellen hijacks some dude's brain and kills them all again. Ellen and Ryan dress up like the Chinese dude they just killed and head into the submarine to enter the super secret underwater Chinese base. We flash forward again to being captured and get to watch them torture Ryan. It doesn't really matter if you talk or not, by the way. Again, nothing fucking matters. We flash back again and Ryan and Ellen have just arrived at the base.
And they are instantly captured. Great plan, guys. I mean, what? It took them 3 seconds to realize you weren't Chinese? Also, we find out that they have force fields that don't allow the ghost to escape, and that includes Aiden. This means that Jody and Aiden are separated for this small part of the game, while Aiden has to take matters into his own hands and shut down the magic doors. This is incredibly dumb for the sole fact that after this part, we become attached back to Jody, which I just don't understand. I mean, the cord that connects the two of them was basically cut, so why would he still be reliant on her? You know what would be cooler than this? If Aiden was permanently detached from Jody, but he decided to stay by her sides at all times. That would be a neat little way to show that Aiden truly loves Ellen Page. Kind of like that scene from Air Bud.
Go! Get out of here! Don't you understand? Get! I don't want you anymore!
But instead of that, we get this one big missed opportunity.
Aiden comes back to Ellen and heals her wounds, and then we have to go around and find Ryan. He bails out like the huge pussy he is, and Ellen finds some explosives and a dumb underwater walking suit. She walks through the interdimensional portal, plants bombs everywhere, and after that we run away from some giant fucking ghost fish and come back to the Chinese torture man still wanting to fight. We fight with him for a bit, like a scene exactly out of Indiana Jones, and then the giant ghost fish comes and kills him. The whole place starts to flood, and Ellen barely makes it back to the submarine before the entire place explodes. They swim back up to the surface, wearing barely anything, in the fucking ice tundras of China. Luckily, the two guys you left behind somehow find you right away. It's a fucking miracle.
Flashing back to the Green Goblin losing his family, we see Cole explaining to Ellen Page about what happened and how he lost his family. I'm glad he decided to do this now so that all the emotional impact of that scene is completely gone. Really makes me feel that much more detached, but I digress. Cut to a little tossing and turning action until, oh no, dead ghost family! So after barely reacting to seeing two dead fucking corpses in front of her, she does what any normal 7-year-old girl would do, walk by herself in an eerily lit hallway without freaking out. Remember when Ellen Page could barely go into her garage without pissing herself? Well, now at the same age, she's basically fearless. So she walks all the way to the Green Goblin's office where she does some stupid bullshit where she has his dead family talk to him. You know, this would have been really useful in the Navajo sequence to have the dead Native Americans talk directly to her and tell her how to solve the issue, but fuck it. Writing scenes out of order like this totally fixes that issue 100%. Also, Green Goblin, rightfully so, freaks the fuck out.
Now, let's flash forward again. You listen to some pointless stuff and Cole takes you down to the super mega evil lair. You talk to Green Goblin, who shows us the most fucked up shit ever. Basically, he wants us to connect with the other world so that we can bring his family back. But that's pretty messed up, so we're gonna leave instead.
No. Wait, hold up, we aren't just skipping over in that detail. What kind of twist is that? You literally introduced this whole idea like 5 minutes ago, where you could communicate with your dead family. Throughout the rest of the game, chronologically, and throughout the rest of Ellen Page's life, we never once see Green Goblin even hint at trying to get his family back. He never talks about them, never cries about them, just one scene on the night of his family's death. So why does he now, after all this time, tell Ellen Page about how much he misses them? And even then, there is no indication that he is even evil. Throughout the entire game, Green Goblin is seen as such a level-headed guy who wants what's best for Ellen Page. So why is it now that he is suddenly like, fuck it to morals and ethics, and turns into what seems to be a James Bond villain? It is just terrible writing. James Bond villains are written better than this. Trust me, I've gone through this game 3 times now, and they almost never hint at this. To be honest, it is even more jarring if you play this in chronological order, because then you realize that they never mention this, or even hint at this, until here at the end of the game. It's just lazy writing. I would rather have them do the evil government is trying to use these powers they don't understand for world domination trope. Wait, they are doing that too! They're doing that too!
Yeah, no, it's fine though. Anyways, we get drugged by the CIA, and they plan to do with us what they did to our mom. Green Goblin says some more of his evil stuff to us, and then Aiden goes to save the day. He flies up to Cole and Ryan and alerts them that Jody is mad fucked. You lead them to your room in the most boring rescue sequence possible, and then Ellen tells them about Green Goblin's super evil plan, conveniently right as he executes it. Everyone starts getting murdered, besides our three protagonists, of course. We put on our dumb magic crystal suits and head towards the condenser to blow it up.
Cole and Ryan get held back by some plot convenience bullshit, so it's only Ellen Page wandering in the condenser. Here she finds a ton of ghosts that are of real people, and she then stumbles upon the Green Goblin, with a fucking gun in his hand. You might be asking, why does he have a gun? What's he gonna do, shoot the ghost? No, he's gonna kill himself, of course. Aw, man, what a shame. Hold up. No. You can't be this insensitive. No. Fuck you. It is showing him having a happy reunion with his family after killing himself. Okay, just think about that for a second. This is David Cage. He is saying if you ever had a dead relative, or if times are harsh, the answer is to fucking kill yourself. The game in no way ever portrays what he did here as a bad thing, but instead shows how much happier he is afterwards.
What happened?
He found what he was looking for.
The same thing could have been shown with a little more class if he died to a monster or something and was with his family, but instead he shot himself in the head. This is David Cage saying suicide is the option. I'm sorry, but this is without a doubt the most disgusting and vile thing I have ever seen in a game. Telling your audience that suicide makes everything just magically better, it's horrible. It's horrible. And in case you want to be even angrier, just remember the fact that people defend this game. This right here perfectly shows why I hate this game so much and why I hate David Cage just so fucking much. From the bottom of my heart, sincerely, fuck you, David Cage.
Anyways, Ellen and Ryan reunite, and Ellen has to do these big dodges from spooky ghosts. Your belt breaks, and Ryan gives you his, and gives you a big smooch, and then you head towards the center of the condenser. We see a bunch of stupid ghosts trying to stop us. Not only that, but we start aging backwards. Like, man, what the fuck is this shit? But don't worry, this shit isn't the dumbest part. The dumbest part is the biggest plot twist of all time. Who is Aiden? Why do we have this ghost man helping us through the entire game? It's because he was our twin brother, and he died during childbirth. Yes, seriously, this is the twist. Why does our twin brother give us magical powers but no one else? Who the fuck knows, really? Who the fuck knows?
And you want to know what's just even worse? Now you get a choice at the end of the game. Want to go back to your shitty, drab, dreary life? Or want to fucking kill yourself also and live in the cool-ass, sick-ass ghost world? Once again, killing yourself is shown in this awesome, fantastic light. Do I even need to talk about the alive ending? She stays alive, does whatever in the real world. If she kills herself, she gains this mass amount of knowledge and has an awesome life. So remember, guys, David Cage thinks suicide is awesome. Oh, and also, here's some sequel bait with the hobo's daughter and Ellen Page in Terminal. Fuck this game. Seriously, I hate it more than Indigo Prophecy.
Also, why the fuck are the ghosts even attacking you if they're just from the dead people world? Why are they attacking the other world? Why do they want to destroy the world? Who fucking knows? Especially since now, if you become Ghost Ellen, you see that people exist on that world and they're all chill with it. I don't get it. It doesn't make any sense. Anyways, that's Beyond Two Souls. Easily the worst in the David Cage saga, unless you really like the message that suicide's the answer. Seriously, David, fuck off. If this game doesn't highlight how much of a mess David Cage games are, I don't know what else possibly could. And in case you're wondering, I've played the game in chronological order, and it's not any better. The pacing is shit, things get introduced in super weird ways, and it still makes almost no sense.
To be quite honest, Indigo Prophecy is the worst game, excluding Omicron. However, I hate this game more because of what it represents and how I personally like the concept of this game. Controlling Aiden with a friend is a neat idea, and I am a sucker for weird sci-fi adventures. Like I said, one of my favorite shows right now is Stranger Things, that takes the same sort of tropes this game uses. But since the game handles these themes in such a poor way, and has one of the worst, just disgusting morals and endings I have ever seen in a game, I hate it so much more. By the end of Indigo Prophecy, I was just too bored to care. By the end of Beyond, I was literally disgusted by what I had just witnessed. That's the truth.
But now, we're done. We've come to an end. And the David Cage games have been finished. But on May 25th, that won't be the case anymore, and Detroit Become Human will be released. So I think the best way for us to end this video is to figure out the common tropes between every game and take a guess at what we think will end up in Detroit Become Human. Start it off for me, Vinny.
Well, Shane, we have Unnecessary rape!
Child murder!
Racist stereotypes!
An irredeemably evil person!
Female lead walking around in her underwear!
Female lead showering!
Character trait that is rarely ever brought up or explained!
Supernatural bullshit!
Fuck you, mentally ill person!
Kill yourself!
Homelessness and a subcategory of homeless society.
Crooked cops.
A complete lack of understanding how the cold works.
Choices don't actually matter.
Horribly unengaging gameplay.
Tacked on stealth.
Stealing ideas from games and movies.
And how could we forget? A complete collapse of the story within the last hour.
So basically, expect that all these things will happen in the next game, except just adding the word robot next to them. The best part is, a lot of tropes are already seen in the demo and promotional material. You see a bunch of homeless robots, you see irredeemably evil people, child murder, suicide, a complete lack of understanding how the cold works, and worst of all, stealing ideas. I mean, for fuck's sake, this game is coming only a year after Blade Runner 2049 and Nier Automata came out. Two games that handle all the ideologies that will be shown in this game with blurring the line of what makes a machine and a human.
Remember though, this game really isn't about that stuff. This whole thing is a thinly veiled metaphor for racism in America. I mean, it should be obvious, but look, it's even taking place in Detroit, the place that had horrible race riots in the 60s. This is very clearly what David Cage is aiming for. He wants to explore this incredibly sensitive topic using robots, and I can't imagine a worse person to do it.
Speaking of terrible and offensive, this video just wouldn't be complete without talking about how great David Cage has been doing at Quantic Dreams recently. If you don't know, a couple months back, David Cage's company, Quantic Dreams, had an article written about them by two different reputable French magazines, basically showing how shit the working conditions there are. This includes an insane amount of crunch time for developers there, and a generally toxic workplace. Details in the article by Le Monde specifically calls David Cage difficult to work with, and with multiple counts of racist, homophobic, and sexist comments by Cage. Also, there were pictures of a farting dick and balls on the wall, and photoshops of Cage on things like Nazis and shit being shared around the office. This gets juicier, because when confronted about this, David Cage's response was, "You want to talk about homophobia? I work with Ellen Page, who fights for LGBT rights. You want to talk about racism? I work with Jesse Williams, who fights for civil rights in the USA. Judge me by my work." This is him going, "I'm not racist because I have a black friend." Remember, he's making a game about racism. And it doesn't stop there, because now David Cage is suing Le Monde for slander, a case where he is ultimately going to lose and just bring out more attention to the article. So yeah, other than that, he's been doing great.
Not only that, but the trailer for Detroit has already been lambasted. Not for its issues in displaying racism or anything like that, but because they're already doing a shit job of displaying child abuse, and everyone apparently knows it this time. If these early articles are anything to go by, it's pretty easy to see that Detroit will be a disaster. So there you go. Don't get your hopes up, because it's going to be awful. And I hope you're happy, David. We judged you by your work, and it was shit. Hey, thanks for watching the video. If you enjoyed, be sure to subscribe to my channel for more. And if you really liked hearing my voice, check out my Twitch channel at twitch.tv/Shafournee, because Monday, starting at 1 p.m. EST, I'm going to stream Detroit Become Human all fucking day. Also, join my Discord and follow me on Twitter, blah, blah, blah. The links are in the description.
If you fuckboys also like listening to me talk about random bullshit, check out all the other stuff on my channel. That's where the first video is hosted, in case you didn't realize that. Also, check out me on my Discord and my Twitter. That should be somewhere in the description or on the screen. I don't give a shit. For all my other bullshit. And just remember, before the end of the video, fuck David Cage and his stupid bald-ass head.
All right, that was a little rude.
Hey, fuck.
All right, goodbye.